Shabbat Shalom. A jealous and avenging God is the Lord. The Lord is avenging and wrathful. The Lord takes vengeance on his adversaries and he reserves wrath for his enemies. This is what the Bible says in Nahum 1, verse 2. The book of Nahum begins by telling us that Yahweh is a jealous father and that he will judge and punish those who do not follow his commandments. That's not something we like to hear, right? That our Creator, our Father, is a jealous Father who does not hesitate to use judgment when his people compromise. Mix. In fact, we as believers probably read this. This is not for me, but for wicked unbelievers. But we sometimes forget that his word was written as an instruction for us, believers, not unbelievers. The Lord is slow to anger and great in power, and the Lord will by no means leave the guilty unpunished. In whirlwind and storm is his way, clouds are the dust beneath his feet. We always talk about Yahweh as the Father of love, mercy and redemption. And we should, because this is who he is. The misunderstanding, however, is that he always forgives, no matter what. When the lamp broke the fifth seal, I saw underneath the altar the souls of those who had been killed because of the word of God and because of the testimony which they had maintained. And they cried out with a loud voice, saying, "How long, O Lord, holy and true, will you refrain from judging and avenging our blood on those who live on the earth?" Here we read that the martyred saints cry out for justice for those who live on earth, those who are connected to the world, those who are not born again, those who believe in the flesh. This is contrary to what people believe because they lack knowledge. The first major lack of knowledge is that we approach the Bible from a Reformed, so-called Christian perspective, rather than from a Jewish perspective. The church fathers turned Yah's apostolic Jewish master plan into a worldly Gentile master plan and turned prophecy into a prediction and fulfillment, while Yahweh uses prophecy for multiple fulfillments in different time frames. The second major lack of knowledge is that prophecy is not just a fulfillment, but a pattern. A repeating pattern that always connects the Old Testament with the New Testament. If we do not study Daniel's abomination of desolation in the Old Testament, Antiochus and Hanukkah, we will not understand why Joshua celebrated Hanukkah, and that the abomination of desolation will happen again at the beginning of the Great Tribulation. We previously made an extensive video about this called Hanukkah End Time Mystery. Antiochus, a foreshadowing of the coming Antichrist. He took his seat in Yah's temple. So who is the liar but the one who denies that Jesus is the Christ? This is the Antichrist, the one who denies the Father and the Son. Is it a coincidence that the current temple on the Temple Mount in Jerusalem, the Dome of the Rock, contains the text, "Yahweh has no son"? Prophecy is a pattern. A pattern, a repeating pattern, so that we can learn from, so that we can prepare. And this is why we need the Old Testament as a basis for understanding the New Testament. Yahweh always shows us the end from the beginning in his prophecy. We cannot understand prophecy if we do not study and understand history, the Old Testament. Let me give you an example. And then after being warned by God in a dream, he left for the regions of Galilee and came and lived in the city called Nazareth. This was to fulfill what was spoken through the prophets, "He shall be called a Nazarene." Matthew writes in the New Testament about Joseph here, following a dream he received from Yah, and he speaks of a Nazarene, which was spoken by the prophets. But it seems that Yah is testing us here, because nowhere in the New and Old Testament is this name mentioned. So who is this Nazarene? If we study the Hebrew Bible a little, we can discover that the root word for Nazarene is Nazar, translated as branch or shoot. And then a shoot will spring from the stem of Jesse. A branch from his roots will bear fruit. Here we read that Yeshua is the Nazarene, the Nazar, who came from the root of David. In other words, we need the Old Testament. Yah shows us the end from the beginning. So why am I telling you all this? Because of the Bible book of the prophet Nahum. Let's be honest, how many people have studied this book? And what does this book of Nahum tell us? First, Nahum means comfort or consolation, which is already strange because the entire book is about Yahweh's judgment against Nineveh. In the time of Nahum, around 620 BC, there were two rival world powers, Egypt and Nineveh, the capital of the Assyrian Empire. Chapter 1 of the book of Nahum tells us that Yahweh is going to destroy Nineveh. Chapter 2, how he is going to do it. And chapter 3, why he is going to do it. But wait, Nineveh repented, right? Jonah brought repentance to Nineveh. That's right. But Nahum takes place about 140 years after Jonah. Jonah preached and Nineveh repented, but they returned to their worldly behavior and once again placed themselves under the judgment of Yahweh. By the way, we can clearly see here that there's no once saved, always saved. The main theme in the book of Nahum is the undoing of the book of Jonah, a book that represents judgment, and this is important, against the Gentiles, not against Israel. Jonah brings repentance to Nineveh, the Gentiles, known as the sign of Jonah. But wait, the sign of Jonah is about Jonah and the whale, right? Mainstream Christianity teaches us that Jonah's 3 days in the stomach of the whale represents Yeshua's 3 days in the grave as the sign of Jonah, which is correct. But there's a second sign of Jonah, according to the book of Luke. As the crowds were increasing, he began to say, "This generation is a wicked generation. It seeks for a sign, and yet no sign will be given to it, but the sign of Jonah. For just as Jonah became a sign to the Ninevites, so will the Son of Man be to this generation. And the Queen of the South will rise up with the men of this generation at the judgment and condemn them, because she came from the ends of the earth to hear the wisdom of Solomon. But something greater than Solomon is here. The men of Nineveh will stand up with this generation at the judgment and condemn it, because they repented at the preaching of Jonah. And behold, something greater than Jonah is here." Here we clearly read that the sign of Jonah is that the Gentiles repented while the Jews did not. The Jews would not repent. So Yahweh went to Nineveh, to the Gentiles. We must understand that the book of Jonah and Nahum is a harbinger, a forerunner, an instruction to let us know what will happen in this final season. It's all about the coming end time judgment. It is no coincidence that we read the story of Jonah on the Day of Atonement, Yom Kippur. As we study the Nahum book, we will see that he prophesies for the times in which we live. The book of the prophet Nahum writes about three time frames, as most prophets do. His own time, Yeshua's first coming, and Yeshua's second coming. Yeshua tells the church in Sardis, in the final Bible book, Revelation, "So remember what you have received and heard and keep it and repent. Therefore, if you do not wake up, I will come like a thief, and you will not know at what hour I will come to you." In other words, You heard the truth, but you did not respond. Prepare and repent. So what truth is Joshua talking about here to the church of Sardis? The apostolic truth. What happens to those who knew the truth, turned away from it, and compromised? Read Nahum, the destruction of Nineveh. What happened to Assyria, Nineveh, is just a shadow of what will happen at the end of this age. So what happened to Nineveh is a shadow of what will happen to Babylon the Great. And he cried out with a mighty voice, saying, Fallen, fallen is Babylon the Great. She has become a dwelling place of demons, and a prison of every unclean spirit, and a prison of every unclean and hateful bird. We will get what Nineveh got if we don't repent. We, as believers, don't want to see this. We think that we are doing it right, but we are not. Churches think that they're doing it right, but are they? Why did Joshua tell the Ephesians to take away their lampstand? An apostolic church founded by the apostles Paul, Barnabas, Peter and John. Did Joshua tell them this because they were doing well as a church? How many churches are apostolic today? Follow the Feast of Yahweh, His appointed times, Shabbat, Moedim. Why would Joshua take away their lampstand then, but not today? If it happened to the church of Ephesus, it can happen to any church. The Baptists, the Pentecostals, the Reformed Church, the Methodist, the Roman Catholic Church. Are we different today from the church of Ephesus? Replacement theology, no more law but grace, no more feasts, no more Shabbat, same-sex marriage, evolution, euthanasia, 74 million abortions worldwide per year. Would Joshua let us keep our lampstand? The judgment of Yahweh hangs over us, and Nahum warns us, as Jonah warns us, and Jeremiah and Isaiah and Moses and Elijah, John the Baptist warns us, Joshua warns us, Paul warns us, but the church is asleep. They have no intention of listening. They think that they are doing well by following the man-made world reformers instead of Yahweh's master plan, the apostolic. Your shepherds are sleeping. The word shepherd is Ra in Hebrew, translated as pastor. Your pastors are sleeping. Nahum warns your wound is incurable. Incurable in Hebrew is hala, translated as weak or sick. Please note that Isaiah prophesies about Babylon as for our end time instruction. Nahum prophesies about Assyria as for our end time instruction. And I say to you, it will be more tolerable in that day for Sodom than for that city. Woe to you, Chorazin! Woe to you, Bethsaida! For if the miracles had been performed in Tyre and Sidon, which occurred in you, they would have repented long ago, sitting in sackcloth and ashes. But it will be more tolerable for Tyre and Sidon in the judgment than for you. And you, Capernaum, will not be exalted to heaven, will you? You will be brought down to Hades. Yahweh confronts Nineveh, the Gentiles, saying that they are worse than Sodom and Gomorrah, and Tyre and Sidon, which is a serious accusation. In fact, Chorazin, Bethsaida, and Capernaum were the three cities where Joshua carried out his mission, because they were judged and cursed for compromising his father's message. Joshua lived in the city of Capernaum, a city on the northwest shore of the Sea of Galilee. on the border of Zebulun and Naphtali. Interestingly, the name Capernaum means village of Nahum, or village of comfort. There are no coincidences in the Bible. Anyway, the prophet Nahum tells us very clearly that there will come a time when the Gentiles will make a mess of things. Yahweh first got fed up with the Jews and he turned to the Gentiles. But the time is coming when he will be wary of the Gentiles and he will return his grace to the Jews. Paul writes about this. For if God did not spare the natural branches, he will not spare you either. Behold them, the kindness and severity of God to those who felt severity. But to you, God's kindness, if you continue in his kindness, otherwise you also will be cut off. And they also, if they do not continue in their unbelief, will be grafted in, for God is able to graft them in again. What happens in the story of Nahum to Nineveh is a picture of what is happening now basically to the Gentile church. So was Nineveh better than Sodom and Gomorrah? No, they were worse. Was Nineveh better than Tyre and Sidon? No, they were worse. If Yahweh could cut off the natural branches, why would the church think that they are so special? So special that they think that Yahweh will rapture them exclusively before the tribulation? It doesn't make sense. Is Europe better than Sodom and Gomorrah? No, it's worse. Is Africa better than Sodom and Gomorrah? No, it's worse. Middle East better than Sodom and Gomorrah? No, it's worse. Is Asia better than Sodom and Gomorrah? No, it's worse. And so on. We must understand that the dragon and the snake are always a team. The dragon is the persecutor and the serpent is the seducer. And the great dragon was thrown down. The serpent of old, who is called the devil and Satan, who deceives the whole world. He was thrown down to the earth and his angels were thrown down with him. Most Asian believers celebrate the Chinese New Year, right? As an innocent family gathering, a tradition. But they don't understand what they are actually celebrating. We do not judge, that's not up to us. We can only advise and share what the Bible says. But please understand that the dragon of the Chinese New Year, and also Revelation, has strong connections to the goat in the prophecy of Daniel chapter 8. It is connected to the beast of the abyss, the red dragon, the beast out of the sea, the beast out of the earth, the false prophet, and finally the scarlet beast, Babylon the Great. These are all represented in one main feast, Satan's feast, which is a counterfeit of Passover. Paul clearly warns us about all this. But I am afraid that as the serpent deceived Eve by his craftiness, your minds will be led astray from the simplicity and purity of devotion to Christ. This is exactly what we see happening today. People celebrate the Chinese New Year as a harmless tradition because their minds are being led astray by the world, the flesh, and Satan, not by the Father. In ancient times, the prophets didn't want to tell Yah's truth because people do not like the truth. Jeremiah didn't want to go out and tell the truth. Ezekiel didn't want. Elijah didn't want. Jonah, he fled to Tarshish. The prophets didn't want to share the truth. We see it happen again in the New Testament. Peter also did not want to go to the Gentiles with the truth. So what about today? What about today? Do people like to hear the truth? Or do they prefer to defend themselves about the feast of Yahweh, or his Shabbat, or his law, or the Chinese New Year, and so on? That which has been is that which will be. That which has been done is that which will be done. So there's nothing new under the sun. We sometimes forget that his word was written as an instruction for us, believers, not unbelievers. We sometimes forget that the Father has an exclusive claim on our obedience. We sometimes forget that the Father destroyed earth, including his people, with a flood. We sometimes forget that the Father destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah. So what about Jericho? And what about Babylon, Tyre, Bethel, Nineveh? What about Babylon the Great? We sometimes forget that he is going to destroy the current world around us. Why? Because he is jealous, vengeful, and wrathful Father. Before we end, I have one more question. Why does the book of Nahum mean consult or comfort? What do we need to be comforted about? The Lord is good, a stronghold in the day of trouble, and he knows those who take refuge in him. We live in a difficult and a challenging and a changing times, and for the most part not changing for the better. But there is comfort, a true hope, a future fact in his comfort. There is a promise there, a salvation for those who take refuge in him. How? Those who follow his commandments, those who follow the apostolic commandments, rather than the man-made, reformed religious ways. Yahweh comforts. Maranatha. Have a blessed week. Shabbat Shalom.